Okay, in this lecture, we are going to be looking into the solid state of matter. This chapter is one of the easiest ones in both IIT JEE and NEET as well. Straightforward questions, repeating patterns. Okay, so it is better that you guys focus on this chapter very well. If you solve all the previous questions, which I'll be solving for you guys in a separate video, if you solve all of those, you should be set for this chapter. Now, first, a little bit of theory. Types of solids. Usually questions of this kind doesn't come in NEET, but regardless, let's not skip it. So when you look into a crystalline material, they have long range order. Basically, atoms self-organize in a periodic array in a really long range. Okay. Among the crystalline material, there can be two types. One is single crystal, where the repeating pattern of periodic array for the entire extent of the material. Meaning, let's say, for example, you take a small amount of that material, the entire amount that you take has the same repeating pattern, continuous. Okay. Whereas polycrystalline is where they have small crystals or grains right there. If you see this, this is one crystal, this is one crystal. This crystal is exactly same as this one in terms of unit cell arrangement, but the array, the direction in which it is arranged is different. And this line is actually called a grain boundary. Polycrystalline material, a perfect example is sodium chloride crystal. Okay, when you take the rock salt at home, it's a crystalline material, but it is not ordered in the same array as that of a single crystal. Single crystals are more expensive and they have to be synthesized most of the times. Okay. Common single crystal that is used is silicon, okay, for a photovoltaic cell of extreme efficiency. If you don't have this type of self-organized periodic arrays, even be it single or polycrystalline, you call them amorphous, disordered. Okay. A couple of properties of the crystalline and amorphous solids. Crystalline solids have distinctive internal structures that in turn lead to distinctive flat surfaces or faces. Okay. What it means is, take a sodium chloride crystal for example. Inside the pellet of sodium chloride you take, there is distinctive internal structure which we will actually see soon, NaCl structure. It leads to flat surfaces. So if you take the crystal and view it, you can have flat surfaces here and there. You can also call them faces. Okay. The intermolecular force holding the solid together are uniform. Okay. Because the intermolecular force is uniform, the same amount of thermal energy is needed to break every interaction. So let's take for example this. The intermolecular force here is same as here, or in the entire bulk. Because it's the same amount of intermolecular force, the same amount of thermal energy is needed. If the same thermal energy is needed, we just call it in a different colloquial way, defined melting point, meaning the entire crystal will melt at a particular melting point, give or take 1 degree. So let's say, for example, you take ice. Okay, ice is a crystalline solid. It melts at 0 degrees. You don't say it melts at 0 to 20 degrees. It melts exactly at 0. Okay. And it's relatively sharp, well defined. This property can be used to identify the unknown material. Amorphous solids, on the other hand, lacks long range order. Okay. See, this is not as organized as this one. Glass is a perfect example of amorphous solids. Not all amorphous solids are glasses, but all glasses are amorphous solids. They are amorphous and translucent. You don't have the glass transition in your syllabus, but at least know that glass is a very good example. And also most of the polymers are amorphous solids. Now, any substance actually can solidify in amorphous form, okay, or can solidify in crystalline form, depending on how you do it. If you cool anything really fast, it will try to get into some type of structure right away. Doesn't have to be ordered as this one. It will be more like this one. So when you take silicon dioxide, SiO2, both of them are made of same material. Whereas when it is an amorphous form, you have what is called quartz glass. Whereas when it is crystalline form, you call it crystalline quartz. Okay. Now going on to the most important type of problems in solid state, they are going to deal with unit cells. What is a unit cell? It's the smallest group of atoms which has overall symmetry of a crystal. These type of things are good enough to understand, but basically what you want to do is you want to know a unit cell in terms of a repeating pattern. If you take this as the whole crystal that you are going to take, this small cube repeats itself everywhere. Okay, so that is called a unit cell, the smallest repeating pattern. If it can be further divided into a repeating pattern, that okay, let's say you take a big unit cell, okay, perusa onu edukringa, adu ulla oru chinna chinna da repeating pattern irukku, smaller ones, then that becomes a unit cell. Okay, the entire lattice can be built up by repetition of unit cell in 3D. So you take boxes, let's say one box, you arrange boxes around it, that becomes the entire lattice. But that one particular box or any particular box will be the unit cell. When you take a unit cell, there are certain parameters you need to know. Okay, it can be a cube or it doesn't have to be a cube. It can be made out of, okay, parallelogram, not exactly a square. Okay, square in a 3D upon a cube, but this is a parallelogram, okay, made into 3D. So the angles don't have to be 90 degrees, they can be any. So we can give them alpha, beta and gamma, and the lengths, if they are equal, you form a perfect cube. If not, you form a cuboid. Both of them are okay. Even here the cube becomes a repeating pattern, here this particular structure becomes a repeating pattern. So your unit cell doesn't have to be a perfect cube, but it just have to be a repeating pattern. Here are the 7 fundamental kinds of unit cell in the entire universe. Okay, all the unit cells that you have in the entire universe will fit into one of these. They are actually straightforward. You take a proper cube. Okay, if you take proper cube, what you have is all the lengths are equal right there. All the angles are 90 degrees. Now what you can do, imagine that I keep the angle the same. In the cube only, I am pulling it up. If I pull it up, my length and breadth are still the same, but it's not equal to height. That becomes tetragonal. And then I pull it on one more side this way. Okay, so my length is not equal to breadth, is not equal to height, but my angles are still 90 degrees. Now what if I push this to one side? Shear force. Appa bend aga podu. Okay, so these are all the ones possible. Now you are expected to remember all of them. Okay, rarely question comes straight from that. If you cannot remember all of them, at least remember basic ones: cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic. Okay, it's a set, simple. All of them are 90 degrees, CTO. Your length is equal to breadth is equal to height. The height is not equal, all of them are not equal. You can remember that. Then remember triclinic, none of them are equal. Okay, and you can remember rhombohedral. Rhombohedral and cube are pretty much similar in terms of the sides, except the angles are not 90 degrees, that's all. So if you see, these three are one set, this and this are exactly same except the angles are gone. Okay, this is exactly opposite of cube. You can remember 5 of them right there. Now these two are little bit different. Now that you have 7 fundamental kinds, okay, in the 7 fundamental kinds you can put the spheres everywhere, atoms. Based on that you can have 14 Bravais lattice. Okay, these are the 7 types that we just saw. In the 7 types, okay, there are types of unit cells where I can put only in the corner. So if you see, all of the 7 types get one type of unit cell where all of them are in the corners. Okay, now what you can do, right in center of the body we can put. Okay, that gives in 4 different. Trigonal does not form this, triclinic does not form this, hexagonal does not form this, but the remaining 4 forms it. I can also do a base centered, meaning only at the bases and the center of the base I can put, or face centered. You don't really need to remember all of the 14 Bravais lattice, but what's more important for us is these 3 cubic ones. This is what we are going to see in detail in solid state. Now if you can actually see, if you have seen basic solid state in school, this is simple cubic, body centered and face centered. We'll deal with one after the other. These are the 3 cubic unit cells you are going to see. These are pictorial representation. Have a look at them and try to get an visual imagination. Okay, it helps you in solving solid state problems. If you are able to visualize it, okay, it will be easier. And I always tell my students in class, the best way to visualize this, the cube is the room that you are sitting in. If this is the room you are sitting in and you are at the center, okay, now you can visualize around you. How is it? Where you are sitting is called body centered. Okay, at your arm's length on either side, front limb, back limb, on top and bottom, okay, left and right, that's your face centered. It's just a little bit easier way to remember them. Now, when you have these type of unit cells, how much do they contribute? Okay, this is straightforward math. When you look at it, in a corner, if you take a corner of a unit cell, if you take a unit cell, okay, this particular corner is shared by 8 other unit cells. Okay, just like boxes, if you take a box and you put boxes around it, okay, this is a box, there's 4 boxes around it, and I can keep 4 on the top. So that means this particular point is in intersection of 8 different corners. So if I put a sphere here like this one, it contributes 1/8 to this unit cell and 1/8 to all the other unit cell equally. So each atom in a corner counts half. Face centered is straightforward. If I put it in the face like right here, okay, this half belongs to this unit cell. Okay. Similarly, this half belongs to this unit cell. The top belongs to this unit cell. The bottom belongs to the unit cell below that. So any face centered, okay, will lead to a contribution of half to the particular unit cell. Body centered is right in between. None of the other boxes are touching it, so it contributes completely. Edge center is nothing but, it's not shown here, these are edges. Okay, these are edges. What if I put one in the edge center? Okay, that's what they are talking about. If you put in a edge center, how many of them will lead to it? Okay, so this is the edge. We will see NaCl, it actually comes as a proper edge center. Now these are the lattices, primitive, body centered, face centered, all those atoms per unit cell. If it is simple cubic, I have only 8 cubes on the side, 1/8 each of them. You can calculate this math, you can do it yourself, right? Again, having a little bit of imagination, it's a little easier. Let's go one by one in detail. A simple unit cell or a simple cubic has spheres at each corners, and each of them contribute 1/8. So the total number of spheres per cube is 1. Each atom has only 6 nearest neighbors. So what it means is, if when you take this one, okay, it has one in the back, one in the left, similarly one in the right on the next unit cell, one in the front, one on top, one on bottom. So if you take this, this is the cell that we are looking at. Okay, if you take this cell, okay, this is this cell, this particular sphere, when I'm looking at it, this particular sphere has coordination number of 6. This is extremely important. The coordination number, they'll ask you straightforward, coordination number is 6, meaning it's touching 6 are the nearest neighbors. Obviously, it's not touching a lot of them, only 6, they are all far away. Okay, and if you see this, this is an octahedral arrangement, just like a chemical bonding. Okay, that's what you have here. Okay, if you were to draw it differently, octahedral arrangement. Okay, coordination number is 6. It's an inefficient way. You can actually pack more atoms in a given cube, but this is not an efficient way. Your percent volume occupied by these spheres in a given cube is 52%. There is a way to calculate it. I'm going to be showing it to you in the next slide. You have to remember this number. Straightforward, they'll ask you this. All right, now when you take, let's go back a second. So let's say, for example, this is the cube. I'm going to be looking at only one side of it. A side looks like this. Okay, a side looks like this. Now here I'm calculating atomic packing factor or packing efficiency. Both are exactly same depending on who is asking the question. Packing efficiency is what is used in NEET and IIT. Atomic packing factor is used by solid state chemist. It's nothing but, let's say you take the room that you're in. What is a percent space occupied in the room? That's what a packing factor is. Okay. So in a given cube, only the spheres are assumed to occupy volume. So volume occupied by all atoms in a unit cell divided by volume of the unit cell. Volume of the unit cell is extremely straightforward. Volume of the unit cell is always length into breadth into height. Okay. When you take a simple cube, like all the cubic structures that we have, okay, we have decided we will do SCC, BCC, FCC. All of them come under cubic system, meaning length equals breadth equals height. So volume equals A cube. Okay. A is this given length. Okay. In simple cubic, A equals 2R. You want to remember this. This is a relation you want to remember. A equals 2R or R equals A by 2. Okay. Now, how do you calculate the packing factor? Volume of atoms. There is 1 by 8 times 8 atoms. So, there is 1 atom per unit cell. So, 1 atom times, what is the volume of each atom? 4 by 3 pi R cube. So 4 by 3 pi r cube, but r equals a by 2. So 4 by 3 pi a by 2 is 0.5 a cube divided by a cube. If you do this math, a cube will cancel out. Okay. You can put the value of pi, you will get a packing efficiency of 52%. Also remember, they may ask you the opposite, percent free space. Percent free space is 100 minus 52, 48%. Next, we go into body-centered cube, where just like SEC, this one looks exactly like SEC, except there is one additional atom in the center, right in the body center. Okay, imagine the room you're sitting in, right in the center of the room, there is one more. Okay, here the coordination number, if you see, it is attached to 4 in the top, 4 in the bottom. Okay, coordination number is 8. Packing efficiency, if you calculate just like the previous way, you will get 68%, percent free space is 32. So how do you calculate packing efficiency? So when you take this, this is a little tricky. This is the A, okay? And this is phase diagonal, okay? It's on the diagonal of the phase, or you can take this one also. Phase, they are the same. Here we want to take from here to opposite side. So this is called body diagonal. Okay. See the body diagonal. What you can do, phase diagonal is very simple. Phase diagonal squared. Okay. Phase diagonal squared equals A squared plus A squared. Okay. So phase diagonal equals square root of A squared plus A squared, that is root 2A. Now I know this. Okay. I can do Pythagoras theorem one more time and I can get my body diagonal as root 3a. And if you see the spheres, okay, this is for simplicity they have shown you this, but this sphere and this sphere are actually touching each other. So this is 1r, one radius, one more radius, one more radius, one more radius. So 4 radius equals root 3a, or a equals root 3 by 4a, r equals. So this is something you have to remember, calculations will come. Now, if I know this, I can calculate my packing efficiency based on this. I have just shown you this, how to calculate it. Okay, body diagonal, how to get to root 3a by 4. If you get to this r value, then we can do the same like last time, 4 by 3 pi r cube divided by a cube. Again, a cube will cancel out. But here I have 2 atoms per unit cell, because the corner ones contribute 1 by 8 times 1. Center one contributes 1, so 2 atoms per unit cell. Okay. Alright, next, going into the next one, close pack structures. There are two types, HCP and CCP. CCP is also called face-centered FCC. Okay. Now what you do when you take a given set of atoms, just like oranges on a shop, okay, they are arranged over this way. The first layer of oranges, the fruit vendor arranges it this way. The second layer can be arranged on the voids here. Okay. Now when you see this, I can put a sphere here, 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 or here, okay, around this. They are the same, but there's two types of them. In principle, all six are same, but if you see alternate ones, I have labeled the same. This B, 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 and C, C, and C. The reason, because if we put it in B, this is still free. There won't be any space to put. If you put the actual size, this will be the actual size. Then the actual size is not enough here, so you can only put it in B and B. Okay. So that's what this layer is. I put it in B, meaning C, there is not enough space. Right. So now, so far, so good. Second layer is fine. The third layer is the one that matters. The third layer, I can imitate A. So I have A. On top of that, I put B, and then on top of that, I put A. It imitates these two. So I have A, B, A, B, A, B packing. That's called hexagonal close pack. Okay. These three are hexagonal close pack. Right. Just shown differently. This is shown from the side. This is shown from the top. Okay. There are six of them. Below that, there are six of them, just staggered a little bit. But I can, what I can do is, instead of putting the third layer on top of A, okay, this is A. On top of, instead of putting that, I'm going to put in this place C. Okay, that's what this is. So I can put it on A. So I have A, B, A, which is HCP, or I can put A, B, and C. They are both extremely similar in terms of packing efficiency. So the fruit vendor will not actually know how he has done this. Okay, because it's going to pack the same. So he will get his desired result. But in solid state, they are different. One is called hexagonal close pack when you have ABAB pattern, cubic close pack or FCC when you have ABCABC pattern. Okay, now both of them have the same efficiency and same coordination number 12. Okay, this is something you want to remember. How do you get 12? Let's take this one for example. This particular layer, okay, and we will go to the B right here. Okay, I have put B right there. Now if I put a B right there, let's take this B. Okay, it's attached to three different A's. So the B is attached to three different A's, and there is six of them around it. So there is six B's around it. Okay. Now, if I am going to imitate my third layer exactly like A, I should have the same here. So, there are 12 people around me. 3 plus 6 plus 3 is 12. So, coordination number equals 12. Same over here. What I have here is, I have my B. It's attached to three different AAAs here, and then six B's around me, and then on the top I have CCC. So I have 3 plus 6 plus 3 is 12 coordination number, right? So we will see actually FCC in detail. Lot of questions need come from FCC or CCP structure, cubic close pack or FCC. The coordination number is 12, as I just shown you. Packing efficiency, we will see the calculation, 74. Percent free space is 100 minus 74. So when you see FCC, you can see it this way on the side. Okay, the spheres are touching on the side. So this is one radius. This is one radius. This is one more radius. This is one more radius and one more radius. So four radius equals root 2a, Pythagoras theorem, or a equals 4r by root 2, or you can say r equals root 2a by 4. Okay, however you want to do. Okay, now I have shown you how to calculate it, root 2 a by 4. You have to remember these. I have summarized in the table also in a different sheet. Okay, now calculating it exactly same, except what is it that is changing in all of the calculations? FCC, BCC, FCC. Two things. The number of atoms. SCC means 1, BCC means 2, FCC means 4. Okay, right. So now how do you get 4? If you want, I can show you this. The corner ones contribute 1 by 8. The face center one contributes half. Correct? And there are 6 face centered times 6 is 3. There are 8 corner ones. So there is 4 for FCC. Right? So 4 times 4 by 3 pi r cube times. So divided by a cube. Now, I told you this changes for all of them, and also the relation between R and A changes. So this changes. Accordingly, you will get different ones. Now, HCP also has the same property. All these three are same for HCP because they are both same. Just that this is ABC, ABC pattern. HCP is AB, AB pattern. All right. Again, I have summarized this. I will also send you this like last time my presentation, I sent it to you as PDF. I'll send it to you as PDF. You don't have to write it down, print it and keep it. You are expected to remember. Looks like a lot of math, but you don't need to remember all of them. This is simple. We just saw this. Okay, number of atoms per unit cell. I want to be clear here. Number of atoms seems like FCC and HCP are same, but number of atoms is higher here. Doesn't mean that it is better packing efficiency. This is a larger unit cell. It's a hexagonal close pack. This is cubic close pack. So it comes out to be the same. All right. But you want to remember the numbers. And atomic radius, I told you guys to remember. Okay. Now they can ask you the ratio itself. Ratio of radius. SCC, BCC, FCC. All right. So now when you see the radius ratios, you can see that it is a by 2, a by root 3, a root 2. Okay. Now can we write it as a by root 4? Root 4 is 2. A by root 3. This is a by root 2. Okay. Sorry, this is r equals a root 2 by 4. A root 2 by 4. That's a by root 2. This is a lot easier to remember. A by root 4, a by root 3, a by root 2. So this is a lot easier. This they don't ask you, not that important. Okay, volume of unit cell is simple. Just this alone you remember. They rarely ask you this. Don't need to remember this. If you have trouble, you can do it yourself. Just from the formula. Volume of the spheres divided by volume of the cube. Coordination number is important. You have to remember them. 6, 8 and 12. The efficient ones are FCC and HCP. And person occupied. If you know, you can do the person free space. Alright. Next, going into radius ratio and voids. Radius ratio is nothing but the radius of cation over radius of anion. Usually the cation is smaller than anion. Okay. So when you see the radius ratio, it starts from 0.155 to 1, meaning cation is always smaller. Okay. Now you want to remember this numbers, the values. You want to remember the values. Okay. If you remember the values, you can calculate what type of coordination it will form. Okay. These two are in particular, or actually I can say these three, okay, or maybe sorry, these three, okay, they are also called voids. We will see void right now. They are also called voids, right? Now what does it mean? So this, we have the layer, we saw this before, just like the fruit vendor, and I can put B atom and A atom on the top. Okay, so when you take, for example, four different oranges, okay, I arrange them this way. If you keep one on the top, this area, empty area here, doesn't get filled completely. There's a small gap in between. That's called the void. And there are two types of void you're going to see, depending on how you arrange. Okay. Remember, when you do ABAB pattern, okay, that void where you have the fourth atom right here, okay, this particular void is attached, or you can say it is close to these three spheres and one sphere on the top. So it is attached to four of them. This is called tetrahedral void. It forms like a tetrahedron, three spheres on the bottom, one on the top. That's called a tetrahedral void or a tetrahedral hole, THV. Octahedral void is a little difficult to imagine, but this is nothing but, go back to your ABC ABC arrangement. I have my A layer on top. If I keep B, what happens to the C layers? Okay, that's what this is. C layer is still empty. That's your octahedral void. When you see the faces, four faces are there of the shape that is formed, this tetra. This is six faces, that is octa. Octahedron is this, but when you look at it like this, it's hard to imagine the void. Okay, there are two different triangles in octahedral void, right? This is a triangle, this is a triangle. So if you see these spheres, it's not easy for you guys to see at your level. If you see this, that's what this is shown differently. Okay, anyways, what you are supposed to remember is just a few things, not everything entirely. Okay, you want to remember a few things. My octahedral void is in this ratio. So cation anion ratio either vandadna, the cation is sitting in the octahedral void. If it's in this ratio, the cation is sitting in the tetrahedral void. OHV, THV, and the coordination number you have to remember. Okay, that's all. You don't have to visualize. Nobody is asking you to draw this. Just be able to say when I tell you what void it is. Okay. Now, where are these voids present in a given unit cell? For this, first you have to assume that the one of the ions form the lattice here. When it forms a BCC type lattice, the center is the void. Okay, let's go back one slide. See this void right there, cubic void. That's just BCC structure right there. BCC structure, this is the void. So one atom can occupy this, the main atom can constitute the matrix or the lattice. The tetrahedral and octahedral voids are present, the yellow spheres. When you take, let's say, the anion as FCC, it's in the corners and the face center. In a FCC crystal, the body center is free and the edge centers are free. So the octahedral voids, you want to remember, they are present in the body center and edge center. Okay. When you take a FCC, okay, this is exactly same as this one, FCC, just shown differently. My body center and edge center are free. Okay. Also, the center of each of these cubes, let's take this big cube and divide it into eight small cubes. Okay, see that this is one cube right there. I'm dividing into, this is not a unit cell, this is a part of a unit cell. This, okay, the center of that is also empty. That's your tetrahedral void right there, THV. So even this one also has here octahedral voids free. Okay, I'm just showing you differently. Octahedral voids in the garden, tetrahedral void. Now, take your room that you're sitting in for example. Okay, cut it exactly half into length, breadth, and height. It will divide into eight different cubes, smaller cubes, right? Your room is cut into eight different small cubes, four on the top, four on the bottom. The center is where you're sitting, is the body center. Okay. Imagine each of the cubes, okay, each of the cube has a center. That's your tetrahedral void. Okay, it's tetrahedral void is a little bit difficult to realize. Over a period of time, you will be okay. Here is a tetrahedral void I have shown. So this is one of the small rooms out of the eight, and right in center is a tetrahedral void. If you look at the tetrahedral void, it's attached to four different atoms. So hence you call tetrahedral. Okay. Now we look into the basic types of unit cell in your syllabus. There's only few of them. NaCl, very, very important. Many questions come from this. What you want to know is chlorine forms the FCC, meaning chlorine occupies the edges and face center. Okay, that's your chlorine. NaCl occupies all of the octahedral void. Octahedral voids are present in body centered and edge center. Okay, so this is body center and edge center. Alright, so now when you see there are how many chlorines are there? 4. You can calculate 1 by 8 times 8 times 1 by 2 times 6. When you take NaCl, if you take this one, this is shared by 4 other spheres. Or book eduthu vechinga adha suthi 4 book vekkalam. So this is 1 by 4 times 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So that's 3 because of edge center and 1 because of body center. So that is 4. So for a given NaCl structure, there are 4 Na atoms, 4 Cl atoms, or 4 NaCl molecule. You need to be remembering this. Questions based on this has come many times. Okay, this is one that you have to remember. Second thing is, both the coordination number of Na and Cl is 6. Okay, so if we take this for example, my Cl is attached to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Similarly, when you take Na, it is attached to 1, 2, 3, 1 in the bottom, 1 here, 6. 1 in the front, 1 in the back, 1 to the left, 1 to the right, 1 to the top, 1 to the bottom. Same. So both of them have the same coordination number. Alright. Now, you have to remember this structure. And another property that you have to remember about NaCl structure is, when you take edge length, A, okay, this is A. These spheres are actually touching each other. So, there is half of this sphere, so radius of chlorine plus radius of sodium plus radius of sodium plus radius of chlorine. So, that equals 2 times radius of chlorine plus radius of sodium, correct? This is nothing but 2 times the radius of these two together is called bond length. So they can ask you what is the bond length, giving you the edge A. Bond length is A by 2. These are the questions you can expect based on a given unit cell. To do that, you should be able to do it. Be able to understand the unit cell, where they are present, what is the coordination number, all those. Okay. This is an important one. It has come many times. Next is zinc sulfide structure. There are two types of zinc sulfide. One of them is important for you, alpha zinc sulfide. Beta is equally important in solid state but not for neat syllabus. Alpha zinc sulfide is also called zinc blend or sphalerite, German name, whereas beta zinc sulfide is called urzite after the French chemist Urz. They are extremely simple. This is ABC, ABC means FCC based structure. This is hexagonal based structure, that's all. This zinc blend structure you have to remember. You don't have to draw them, you have to remember particularly the alpha. Okay. Sulfide forms the FCC matrix. See, these are sulfides, face center and corners. So there are 4 sulfur atoms. Okay. When you take tetrahedral void for a given cube for FCC, there are 8 tetrahedral voids. Remember, I told you 8 different rooms, so 8 tetrahedral void. So if I put zinc 2 plus in all of the tetrahedral voids, I'll get 8 zincs. But I cannot have 8 zinc, charge balance will not be there. Zinc also has to be 4 for charge balance. So it occupies half of the tetrahedral void. So there is 4 on the top. Pinadi one irukum, inge one irukum. There's 4 on the top, 4 on the bottom. It occupies the alternate ones. If it occupies the front top left, okay, front bottom left is empty. Front bottom right is occupied. Front top right is empty. This is back, top right is filled, back, bottom right is empty. Okay, so alternate ones. So imagine that this is how these are present. Okay, on the top and there is on the bottom. 8 different tetrahedral voids. If this is occupied, this is empty. This is occupied means these two are empty, this is occupied. Then this is occupied. Okay, half of the tetrahedral voids. Coordination number of S2 minuses four of sulfur zinc 2 plus is also 4. So you want to remember that. See this zinc, it is attached to 1, 2, 3, 4 different ones. Okay. Similarly, when you take this sulfide, it is attached to 2 different zinc, 2 on the top unit cell. Okay. Similarly, this on the right side unit cell, right side, similarly it goes. Okay. So you can remember this zinc blend is FCC structure. FCC matrix is formed by S2 minus. Zinc sulfide sphalerite has zinc 2 plus in the tetrahedral voids, but not all of them, only half of them, alternate tetrahedral voids. Urzite, just remember this is alpha form, this is beta form. You don't have to remember all this, just know this. This is going to have the same packing fraction as this one, okay, except this is HCP. Coordination number is going to be still 4. If you see, coordination number is still the same. Next is diamond lattice. They don't ask you to draw all this, just a couple of points you have to remember. Diamond lattice looks like zinc sulfide. Carbon is the FCC and carbon also occupies half of the tetrahedral void. So if that is the case, then the FCC carbons give rise to 4. Half of tetrahedral void give rise to 4. So there is total 8 atoms. They are all of them are directional sp3 hybridized bonds. So all the carbons are tetrahedral. If you see this, this is a tetrahedral, this will form a tetrahedral. Okay, all of them are tetrahedral. Coordination number is 4. Because these are tetrahedral, coordination number is not very high, it's not an efficient way of packing. Diamond is not an efficient way of packing. They are far away, so the density is less compared to what it could have been. And this is another way of showing diamond. Okay, either in a repeating pattern eduthingana, if you cut out a repeating pattern, you will get this structure. You don't need to draw any of them, just know couple of points. Coordination number is 4, repeating pattern of 8 atoms, and where are they present? FCC and half of the tetrahedral void. That's more than enough. Next is calcium fluoride structure, one of the easy ones again. Okay, now what we do is just like zinc sulfide structure, except calcium is to fluorine ratio is 1:2, number of atoms. Yeah, calcium forms the FCC. So there are 4 calcium, so there has to be 8 fluorides. So they occupy all the tetrahedral voids. See, there are 4 on the top, 4 on the bottom, center of 8 different rooms. That's all. You want to remember which forms the matrix. This forms the FCC, this forms all tetrahedral voids. Okay, now coordination number is not the same. So far, coordination number of cation and anion is the same. Here, coordination number doesn't have to be, will not be same, because they are different charges. Okay. Fluorine is very simple. It's in the tetrahedral void. Coordination number of fluorine is 4. Coordination number of calcium is twice as much. In other words, charge balance pannum. Fluorine is 4. Calcium is twice as much as charged. So, coordination number is 8. Take this calcium for example. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, bonded to 4 different and 4 on the top. Okay. Similarly, this if you take these 4 and 4 on the bottom of the next unit cell. So, coordination number is 8. If you are able to do this, this is called fluoride structure. If you are able to do this, the next one is very simple. Idhula vandu, the cation forms the matrix. The next one, the anion forms the matrix, O2 minus forms the matrix, where calcium used to be. Okay, CaF2 The opposite of that is Na2O, cation anion, cation anion. The cation forms FCC, here the anion forms FCC. Anion here is all tetrahedral voids, here cation is all tetrahedral voids. Rest is the same. Okay, here we can say that there are total of 8 cations, 8 sodium plus for 4O2 minus. Coordination number is 4:8. The coordination number is opposite of this one. Coordination number of sodium, which is a tetrahedral void, is 4. Oxide is 8. That's a different way of seeing this. Okay, this is another way of seeing. It room running a paakkaradhukku badala. Imagine a small cube inside a big cube. Okay, right in the center. Okay, these are the corners or centers of the 8 rooms that you have. Another way of visualizing. That's all. Okay. Now, when you see the coordination number, it's easier here. On the top, there is the same. So, this is attached to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Coordination number equals 8. Coordination number of this is 4. Right. Okay. There's only one formula in solid state. This come many times. Density formula. Density is mass over volume. Mass of the atoms in unit cell divided by total volume of the unit cell. This is actually straightforward. Total volume of the unit cell is A cube. Straightforward. Mass of the unit cell is contributed because of the spheres. So you need to know, okay, the number of spheres. Okay, number of spheres, and that's what your Z is, and mass of each sphere. Okay. Now, mass of each sphere is molar mass divided by Avogadro number. Molar mass is mass of 1 mole of a sphere. Okay. Divided by Avogadro number will give you mass of 1 mole divided by Avogadro number will give you mass of 1 atom. So, the total number of atom divided by mass of 1 atom will give me the mass of the atoms in a unit cell divided by your volume of the unit cell. Okay. Now, this formula has come many times in NEET and JEE. Okay. What all you need to know? What is the Z, number of atoms per unit cell? If it is SCC, it is 1, BCC is 2 or 4, sorry, BCC is 2 or 1. I'll come down to why it is 1, FCC is 4. This is simple. When do you get BCC equals 1? When they give you not atom, but the unit cell is a molecule. Let's say, for example, cesium chloride. Cesium is at the center, chlorine is on the corners. So there is total 1 cesium chloride. So BCC there is 1. Then how do we compensate for that? Let's say the BCC is only cesium. So there will be 2 cesiums, correct? 2 cesiums, you are putting 2 cesium at a molar mass. But when it becomes a molecule, 2 becomes 1, doesn't mean the density changes. The molecular mass of cesium, the molecular mass of cesium chloride, okay? Again, when you are given an atom, cesium forms BCC, Z equals 2. When I tell you cesium chloride, there is only 1 cesium chloride in a unit cell. So this becomes 1, but the molar mass is that of the compound. Now, what all they can ask you here? Okay. It has been the same repeating pattern. They can ask you density, giving you everything. Okay. They can give you R value, meaning you have to convert to A, the three relations that we saw before. The tough problem here is they can give you density, they can ask you R. So I can give you density, calculate your A value. From A, calculate your R. The only problem that you will always have is A கண்டுபிடிச்சதுக்கு அப்புறம் யூ வில் கெட் ஏ கியூப். யூ ஹவ் டு கால்குலேட் ஏ, யூ ஹவ் டு டூ கியூப் ரூட். ஓகே, தட் வில் பி த ஒன்லி ப்ராப்ளம். ஐ வில் ஷோ யூ ஹவு டு டூ கியூப் ரூட்ஸ் அப்ராக்சிமேட்லி இன் தி ப்ரீவியஸ் இயர் வீடியோ. ஓகே, அதர்வைஸ் திஸ் இஸ் ஸ்ட்ரெயிட் ஃபார்வர்ட். நவ் யூ ஹவ் டு வாட்ச் அவுட் ஃபார் த யூனிட்ஸ். த யூனிட்ஸ் ஹவ் டு கேன்சல் அவுட். திஸ் இஸ் எக்ஸ்ட்ரீம்லி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். ஓகே, இங்கே மீட்டர் கியூப்ல இருக்கு. தே மே கிவ் யூ A in picometers or angstroms, you have to convert correspondingly so that your units cancel out. Okay, the last part is one of the easiest one. Every other here there is a question in NEET based on this, the crystal defects. There are two types of defects, but you guys will be looking into only point defect, deviation from ideal arrangement around a point or an atom. Okay, eda on the unit cell edo or edathla or atom miss agudhu illa dislocate agudhu. Line defect is when you take the entire line or a face from a unit cell. Okay, point defect, there is of three types. One is stoichiometric defect, intrinsic or thermodynamics. See, here it says does not disturb stoichiometry, and it's called stoichiometric. So people confuse this. I say stoichiometric, but it says does not depend. What it means is, whatever defect you have, okay, it's stoichiometrically compensated. For example, let's take a room full of boys and girls. Let's say a couple of boys are missing. Okay, then the ratio of boys to girl is going to change. Okay, that is stoichiometric disturbance. What if the same amount of boys and girls are out? அப்போ வந்து எனக்கு அந்த டிஃபெக்ட் வந்து சேம் அமௌண்ட் வெளில போயிருந்ததுன்னா பாய்ஸ் டு கேர்ள் ரேஷியோ மாறாதுல்ல. தட்ஸ் வாட் இட் டஸ் நாட் டிஃபெக்ட் டிஸ்டர்ப் தி ஸ்டாய்க்கியோமெட்ரி, பிகாஸ் வாட் டிஃபெக்ட் யூ ஹேவ் இஸ் ஸ்டாய்க்கியோமெட்ரிக்கலி காம்பன்சேட்டட். ஓகே, வி வில் சி இன் டீடைல். த ரேஷியோ ஆஃப் கேட்டயான் அண்ட் ஆனியான் இஸ் ஆல்வேஸ் கோயிங் டு பி சேம். இம்ப்யூரிட்டி டிஃபெக்ட் இஸ் வென் ஃபாரின் ஆட்டம்ஸ் ஆர் ப்ரெசன்ட். வெரி சிம்பிள், யூ டேக் NaCl தட் வி சா, புட் சம் ஃபாரின் ஆட்டம் இன் தேர். Or a non-stoichiometric defect where you only remove the one of the components. Okay, sodium chloride crystal la sodium and chlorine rendu me seithu remove panna enak adoda ratio maaradu, that's stoichiometric. Whereas let's say sodium chloride crystal, I take sodium away, my ratio is different, so that is non-stoichiometric. Okay, we'll go in detail. In stoichiometric defect there are four types, you have to remember all of them. Okay, vacancy defect is when you take a any given unit cell, something is missing, like the name says, there is a vacancy. Okay, so now arises when the lattice sites are vacant. So obviously if I'm missing something, my mass goes down but the volume of the unit cell is the same, so my density will go down. So the density concept is important in all of them. They can give you four options to say which among them does not change in density or changes in density. So you want to know, vacancy means I'm removing something, density will change, it will go down. Shown by non-ionic solids. Fair enough. Ionic solid, if an ion is missing, my charge balance will go away. So it has to be non-ionic. Let's say for example, silver. Silver forms some type of matrix. I'm missing couple of silvers here. Ion is not going to be missing, so charge is okay. Just the density goes down. Interstitial is when, I've shown both in the same unit cell. Okay. Interstitial is when constituent particles occupy interstitial site. So on top of what you already have, there is an extra particle. Let's take silver again. In the first case, I'm missing a silver. In this case, I'm not missing, I have extra particles in interstitial spaces. So what happens? Edhir paathadoda adhigama irukum, more atoms in a given space, so density increases. Shown by non-ionic solid. So both of these are non-ionic, because be it removing an ion or adding an ion, charge imbalance will come. So you cannot have. So both of them are non-ionic. One is showing the increase in density, one is showing increase in density. Frenkel and Schottky are a variant of this. Smaller ion missing from lattice site and occupy interstitial. Okay. Now what happens? Just the same. Smaller ion is missing and occupying an interstitial site. What happens? So Frenkel is actually a combination of vacancy and interstitial. Vacancy plus interstitial is Frenkel. An ion misses from its place, vacancy is created. Missing but is occupying a different interstitial void, so interstitial, so it is together. Because it's basically I'm missing from one place but it is actually inside the same matrix, density is not going to be changed much, not changed at all. So in ionic solids, okay, fair enough. Zinc sulfide, AgCl, AgB are all those. Now Schottky defect is, okay, hold on, let's see, right there. Okay, I think these two are in interchange, sorry. So you have to just fix this. So when you see Ag is missing, but it has migrated here. Okay, so my density has not changed. Okay, this is a vacancy defect, this is an interstitial defect, combination is Frenkel. Schottky arises when equal number of cations and anions are missing. Okay, I'm missing a cation, I'm missing an anion. So equal of them are missing, so charge balance is the same. So Schottky is a kind of vacancy defect. Okay, except vacancy is shown by non-ionic solid, Schottky is shown by ionic solids. Okay, obviously because I'm missing, I'll have the same property as here, density is decreasing. So shown by ionic solids. Okay, all of these does not affect stoichiometry, meaning the ratio of cation to anion. Non-stoichiometric defects is where the stoichiometry is affected. Okay, there are two types, metal excess and metal deficiency. Metal excess, as the name says, I have more metal. So how can we have? What it means is I have more of the cation. Arises due to loss of electron by metal atoms to form cation. So I have more of the cation. Alright. This, when you see, okay, let me get my pen. Yeah. Alright. Now, let's say for example, you have NaCl. The Cl minus, I put more Na on the top. The Cl minus will migrate from there and go here for the charge balance. But this Na has come from Na giving Na plus plus electron. So this chlorine goes on the top to balance its charge. In this vicinity, the charge is balanced by this electron. Electron comes here. Okay, this electron, okay, is going to give you what is called a F center, Forbin center. Okay, it gives you color. Okay, in terms of ions, it will depend on the characteristic of the ion. Sodium will give a yellow color. Alright. So F center or Forbin center, German name, it's created when an electron is surrounded by the corresponding positive charges giving rise to color. Here I see that there is no anion. So this is an anion vacancy. So here what I have is I have an anion missing. So in this vicinity I have more cations, so it is metal excess. The other type of metal excess is presence of extra cations, usually arises when metal oxides are heated. Right, now when you see this, when I heat zinc oxide, it forms zinc 2 plus and oxygen, but the charge here used to be balanced. For every zinc 2 plus there is one O2 minus. When I do this, for every zinc 2 plus, I don't have O2 minus, I have only electrons. The charge is balanced, but the anion cation ratio is not balanced. Cation is more, hence it is metal excess defect. Okay. The last one is metal deficiency. When a cation is missing from its lattice size and presence of a cation having higher charge. So let's say for example, you miss a cation of lower charge and you compensate by putting higher charge. This is usually shown by metals that have variable valency. Now I have a perfect example here that you are familiar with. Iron can be 2 plus and 3 plus. Let's take these positions 1, 2, 3. 3 iron 2 plus are missing. So I am losing a charge of plus 6. Instead I am putting 2 iron 3 plus. So I have compensated by my charge. So the pink ones are iron 2 plus. 3 of them are missing. So 6 plus is missing, but I compensated by putting 2 iron 3 plus. Alright, so my valency is satisfied, my charge is satisfied, but there is a deficiency in the number of iron atoms. Okay, it used to be iron oxide means FeO. The ratio used to be 1 is to 1, but the ratio is not 1 is to 1, the ratio is less than 1 for iron. So it can be 0.980. Okay, there is mole concept problem actually based on this 0.98 and O. But all we know is the metal is deficient. So these are the types of valencies you are expected to remember. All of the defects, which one changes in density, which one changes in ratio, which is shown by non-ionic, which is shown by ionic. Okay. Alright. This is the end of solid state lecture. What's remaining is solving our previous year problems. I'll post a separate video for that. seems like a really small chapter, which actually it is small chapter, just have to revise it well. And there are three aspects of questions in NEET and JEE. One is the first one, unit cell. Second is the density based problem. Third is the defect based problem. You can have two questions in solid state in a given year, one from defects and one from the density or the unit cell. We'll do all of them. Make sure you read through this. I'll send you the PDF of this document and we'll solve the problems tomorrow. Okay, thank you guys.